Okay, so I think Toby and Yuval both mentioned that conventional processors are really inclined to want frame-based data, right? You look at a GPU or a CPU, they're trying to get arithmetic density, like you all said, and they're kind of willing to sacrifice redundant data, redundant operations, as the price they pay to keep those pipelines full. Okay. And so if you look at the DBS event streams, these are really sparse, continuous event streams. There's a real opportunity to take advantage of the sparsity of the data. Because okay. You look at these individual RGB frames, they're coming at a relatively low frame rate, like every 30 milliseconds, say, for 33 milliseconds for a 30 FPS camera. And they're dense, right? You've got all these pixels in the borders here that just really aren't doing anything if you think that these this gesture here, for example, where he's waving his hand in a circle. The only really pixels that matter are these blue and purple pixels in the middle here. That's the event stream. And so it'd be really nice to have, rather than a conventional CPU or GPU, something that's much more event-based, like natively event-based processor. And so that's exactly what the IBM TrueNorth neurosynaptic processor is. So this is a chip that's got a million spiking neurons on it. Each neuron has 256 synapses, and they're spread across 4,000 identical cores tiled in a 64 by 64 core array on the chip. So you look at this gold die here. The reason it's so homogeneous is because that's literally 64 by 64 identical cores tiled. Each of those cores has the neuron parameters and synapse weights it's responsible for stored in local memory. So there's over 50 megabytes of on-chip SRAM on that chip, which is one reason it's so big, over 5 billion transistors, which was pushing the size of the GPU at the time it was manufactured, 28 nanometer, using Samsung's mobile process. So the power, as a result, is very low. So at nominal supply voltage, you're looking at nominal, reasonably common workloads. You're looking at 70 milliwatts for that chip right there. It's a large chip. And one interesting thing is that we update the chip, the neurons, every millisecond, essentially. So you might think that's kind of slow. You think a CPU runs a gigahertz clock. But there's so much going on in parallel that you're actually updating 268 billion synaptic events per second on this chip. And the 1,000 system updates per second, the millisecond tick, as we call it, that's an actual real-time tick, right? So you can think of that essentially as a 1,000 frame per second processor in real time. And that's essentially the advantage that we're going for here in coupling it with the DBS, which is also, if you take advantage of sparsity, potentially 1,000 frame per second camera. So it's a neuromorphic chip, and by this we're saying it's a brain-inspired architecture. We're not trying to mimic neurobiology, we're not trying to simulate neurobiology. We're trying to just take some of the really efficiencies of the brain's computation at low power. In particular, we're trying to break the fine-motor bottleneck by making a network of really lightweight cores with all of the computation co-located with memory in each core. That's why each core has its own SRAM for the neuron parameters, for the weights. And they only communicate when events happen. That's why they're spiking neurons, not to mention neurons. So three design principles. You want to be flexible and usable, so they have to be programmable, which means there has to be a simulator and a debugger, which for us meant we want to be deterministic and therefore fully digital. So this comes from a long thread of neuromorphic research dating back to Carver-Mead based on analog asynchronous design. Here we've kept asynchronous, but we've abandoned analog for the programmability constraint. Again, we're trying to minimize data movements in order to capture energy efficiency, which leads naturally to spiking neurons to event-based processing. And we want it to be scalable, so that's why these cores are identical. Not only does it tile core to core on the same chip, but the chips tile chip to chip on the same core, pin threads on the same board, pin to pin with no intervening logic chips. So we've got a couple of delivery platforms. One is a single chip board, which I'll show here. And there are also these 16 chip boards and multi-16 chip board racks that we're delivering to the national laboratories at Lawrence Livermore for supercomputing applications. So just look a little more closely at a TrueNorth core. Each core has 256 spiking neurons, binary neurons. Each core has 256 input lines, and every input line can go to every single neuron in the core. So there's 256 or 256 low precision synapses. So you can have full connectivity within a core, but the one caveat is that any neuron can go to only one output on a different, only one input on a different core. So one-to-one connectivity between cores. So just to show a little animation how this works, this is a little cartoon of a core. So there's 2 to 6 inputs and outputs, and I'm only drawing 3 here. The numbers in these little triangles are the thresholds for the neurons. So when you hit the threshold, you send a spike event along the on-chip router, and it gets routed, in this case, west and then north, and it's going to be routed to the second buffer entry in the input on that core that got sent to it. And the 1 millisecond tick is the time it takes for all of these events to be guaranteed to be delivered to all the cores within the tick, and for all of the neurons to be updated with the additive weighted sum. So that's the basic unit of operation, a natively event-based processor. So this is a great thing to pair with the GDS, right? It's fairly fantastic because there's no transduction step necessary to convert RGB image into spikes. It's a natively spiking camera. And so we're using a DBS128 USB package and plugging that into this little prototype board for the TrueNorth chip, which is going to process the event stream coming out of the GDS and filter it for gestures that we're trying to recognize. And then sending the predicted gestures over Ethernet to a laptop, which is only used for visualization, just so you can see what's going on. So just a little more about the development board itself. It's got a single TrueNorth processor on it, and there's also 4,000 cores and a million neurons. That's the amount of compute we have to play with. There's also a Xilinx Zinc system on chip to handle the interfaces, because the TrueNorth chip is a pure array of cores. There's no drivers for USB or Ethernet, so that's what the Zinc is for. And as a consequence, the board itself burns about nominal 3-watt envelope, and the vast majority of that is the Zinc processor. So this is an example of an application of gesture recognition. So we went around and collected 10 sample gestures from 29 IBM engineers and summer interns. And then trained a convolutional neural network, which I'll talk to you about in a little bit, to just recognize these gestures. So you can see on the right side on the tripod, that's the NS1E TrueNorth board, and the DBS is mounted right on top of that. It's mounted, I don't know, the lead author on the paper we're putting this up. So you got some air drums, next one is air guitar, and then a hand clap. And so I think Arnon was in the training set, so this isn't a great example, but his daughter was not. And so we were pretty happy that this worked as well as it did. So left-hand clockwise, left-hand counterclockwise, right-hand wave, right-hand clockwise, and so on. So you can take this and go end-to-end to an actual motor output or application. And so in this case, all we did is take that exact system, train with slightly different gestures, and hook up infrared LED to remotely control a Samsung Smart TV. Same setup as before otherwise. So the 5 gestures we picked to map onto some of the affordances of the Samsung TV. So volume up is like this finger wave, finger twirl. And then volume down was the finger pinch. And then advancing the channel. So increase the channel number and reverse the channel number, go backwards in the channel. And then half close was select the channel. And so you notice that we're looking at a very small aperture of the DBS. This is actually the first generation of the Samsung DBS. Okay, so it has a much wider, larger resolution. In this first generation of gesture recognition, we were looking at a very small hand aperture, just to get the basic recognition down. So this is David Berg. He's the third author on the CBQR paper where we wrote this up. And he's on stage at the 30th anniversary of the Omni Research Center in San Jose. And he's demonstrating the gesture control using the volume. It's really kind of to see it this way, but he's advancing the channel here and closes his hand to select the channel. So, and what he wasn't told, and found out when he got on stage, is that this was more of a command performance than he realized, because that guy on the far left the Ogden lab director, who's his boss's boss. And the guy sitting next to him is the director of IBM Research, which is the lab director's boss. And so he looks really relieved here, that's why. Okay, so how do we do this, right? How do you program TrueNorth to do stuff? So what you need to do is obviously configure all of the neurons, all the synapses on each of the cores, right? So you've got the neuron properties, what are your thresholds, you know, what kind of leakage you have. Basically, what parameters do you set for the model of the other neurons, making spike and the rates you want. You need to decide which inputs in each core are connected to which neurons in each core, the intra-core connections. And you need to decide where you want the outputs of each core to go to, which point-to-point connections you want to make between neurons and other inputs on other cores. And you really don't want to do this by hand, right? So fortunately, what we've done is we've got something called the Corelet Programming Language. And this is essentially a hierarchical compositional data flow language implemented in MATLAB. So you go into MATLAB, you use all the standard MATLAB loops and so on to set your neurons, set your connections, set your parameters. And you use the Corelet classes, and it automatically compiles from your Corelet program down to the flat logical model specification that the driver then uses to configure the actual SRAM bits on the chip itself. And it is hierarchical so that you can take an individual Corelet, which is a basic MATLAB program to configure these cores, and you can nest them, and you can inherit from them, and you can make Corelets and Corelets and so on. And so, over the years, we've come up with a wide variety of Corelets, which we've packaged in the Corelet library, and we've distributed a number of these to our user community that have received these single-chip prototyping boards. So dozens of universities, institutions, I think National University of Singapore, a number of speakers here actually have been traveling. And so we've continually updating them with the classification engines and optimizations as we go forward. So let me talk about the actual Corelet we use for the gesture recognition demo. And this is work that we've written up and we'll be showing at CBPR next month in Hawaii, if you have a chance to go. So we've got the DBS plugged into the NS1E board, which has a sync six-month chip handling the USB driver. And everything else in terms of computation is done on the TrueNorth chip itself. And then the app of the TrueNorth chip goes via Ethernet, again, via the Zinc to the laptop. The laptop that visualizes it. Okay. So it's going from left to right. So the far left plot is the raw output of the DBS 128, pinned over a single millisecond, which is our tick, or basic unit of time for the TrueNorth chip. The blue box there, which is 208 cores of the 4,000 on the chip, are dedicated to six stages of a temporal filter cascade. So each one is a delay filter of about 60 milliseconds. So you get basically 80 milliseconds or 96 milliseconds of parallel input to the convolutional neural network, which is the basic classifier. So it's a reasonable fraction of a fast-moving gesture. And so the green box is the bulk of the TrueNorth program. This is about 80% of the cores on the chip, 3700 cores. It's a 15-layer convolutional neural network, and you can see C through G are various layers. As you go deeper into the neural network, it gets shallower and deeper in feature space. And the output of the last convolution layer goes into a winner-take-all layer that selects the actual predicted gesture for the software computation. And then there's finally a sliding window to kind of smooth out the predictions, which you're getting at 1,000 predictions a second. And then that goes to the laptop. So how do you actually do this, right? Because there's something funny going on with the spike in neural network, because these are binary events, and moreover, these aren't differentiable. Right? So you can't, this isn't really what deep learning expects. If you're gonna do backpropagation, you expect something that's differentiable. There's also this funny business about low precision synapses, which I didn't really talk about. Traditionally, in deep learning, the compared most evidence that you gain relatively high precision data, 16 bits, here we're talking something like 2 bits, and yet it still works. And finally, there are these significant connectivity constraints, because as I said, each neuron only has a fan out of essentially one, unless you do fancy stuff. So there's a lot of ways to do this. The way we've done it with essentially amounts to boiling in these design constraints, limited connectivity, limited precision, directly into the training algorithm. So then directly training on binary neuron activations and triggers synapse weights using a shadow network of high precision weights and casting it down to low precision for actual deployment and inference. And this has become pretty standard by a variety of groups in a variety of universities and institutions, because a lot of people trying to do mobile inference applications want low power, which means low precision. And the question is, how low precision can you get? So there's a lot of research going on right now on this front. And so you can read about our approach in this PNAS paper from last year. And these are kind of four of the basic things we did to get it to work. So the good news for us is that doing these tricks, even with these constraints built in, you can still achieve at or near state-of-the-art classification on a variety of standard benchmark data sets. Yeah, relatively small. These are, like CIFAR, CIFAR 100, street house numbers, and a couple of audio data sets. But the good news is, if you throw enough cores at it, throw enough neurons, you do start to look like you're asymptotically approaching state-of-the-art. And the question is, how much hardware are you willing to spend on this? So if you look on the bottom axis here, this is the number of TrueNorth chips you would need to actually get that performance, the accuracy on the y-axis. So most people only have one chip, right? So that's not so great for something like CIFAR 100, which you'd want multiple chips for. So one thing I didn't really focus on is, remember I said that the basic unit of computation of time is a millisecond. It's not quite true because this is actually a fully asynchronous chip. And so what we have as a millisecond going into the chip is actually a handshake line. And so you can toggle the thing as fast or as slow as you want. If you toggle too fast, then your events don't arrive within that tick period. But you can overclock up to, in this case, 2600 frames per second for some of these data sets. And you can go as slow, obviously as slow as you want if you don't care about that. And power is dependent on the clock speed, so you can spend as much power as you want. So then the other thing you can do is treat accuracy, classification accuracy, as design parameter, right? So this is the convolutional neural network specification for the gesture recognition demo. The NIN means network layer, that's one of these deep learning things. And the rest are convolutional pooling layers. And we spent, as I said, 80% of the cores on the chip to get about 90% classification accuracy on our data set. But what you can do, it turns out, is get spend dramatically fewer cores and get pretty close to the same accuracy, right? So 86% accuracy for a real demo, a live demo, for all intents and purposes, is as good as 90%. And yet, I'm only using 20% of the chip here, which leaves 80% of the chip to do other stuff in parallel, right? So one of the last things, I'll just conclude with this one, you can compose these other correlates to do things like optic flow, for example. So this is the Samsung Gen 2 DBS. You can see it kind of to the left of the monitor here. And we're using an old DBS 128 algorithm, which we ported to the Samsung DBS, to do optic flow. So you can see on the left panel on the monitor is the raw DBS input. The right panel are the vectors from his hand gestures doing optic flow. So this is work by a lot of people in a lot of places. Mainly IBM, Samsung, and obviously Taba. So we did the whole thing from the start, right?